Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
God's mercy is yours forever.
To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
O God, in you I trust.
You are the God of my salvation.
To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
In you I hope all the day long. Remember, Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in whom I trust.
The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord who is full of compassion and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away your wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew the right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Holy God, holy and mighty,
Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all of your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female servant, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in the 6 days the Lord has made heaven and earth, the sea, and all it is that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving to you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, your neighbor's house, or male or female servant, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
The Lord is clean and endures forever. judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold. Sweeter far than honey, in our home. I then also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound, and innocent of a great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my
a reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are preaching, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. The Passover was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip out of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, including the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The people then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The people then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. My grandmother taught Sunday school for over 50 years. Standing at the front of a sanctuary in her one-room church, with only a Bible in her hand, she could hold the attention of her small yet faithful class. She liked to write letters, and whenever I received her weekly letter, it would always have three parts: the family news, the community news, and the sermon. And she liked to give religious jewelry as presents. On the day of my confirmation, she gave me a praying hands necklace, silver hands folded in prayer, mounted on a faux pearl pendant. "To remind you to pray," she said. Even her gifts came with a sermon. And then another time, she gave me a Ten Commandments charm bracelet. "To encourage you to be a good girl," she said. She meant well. She thought it would strengthen my faith. And yet I grew up in a culture where the threat of hell was real, where sin was something we talked about, and guilt was heavily encouraged. I was an oldest grandchild and an oldest child, and like many oldest children, I was conscientious, serious, and a perfectionist. The pressure to be a proper young Southern lady and a good girl already seemed enormous. The thought of another set of expectations to meet, even God's, felt overwhelming. That bracelet represented to me 10 opportunities to fail. A generation later, I am the Sunday school teacher, sitting on the floor of a godly play class, my hands in a box of sand. Godly play is a way of sharing Bible stories with children in a contemplative manner, using objects that children can see and touch and move. It deepens their reflection. It invites sacred play and holy imagination. The box of sand was our desert box in which the stories of God's life with God's people unfold. In this box, the children have heard and seen the clank and the thud of a big metal chain dropped into the sand. God's people cut off from Jerusalem, forced into Babylon, exile. In this box, children have seen the blue felt water rolled back by the hand of God, allowing God's people to pass through on dry land into freedom. Exodus. And now, in this box, they see God's people, wooden figures of men, women, and children, gathered in the sand at the foot of a mountain, Moses before them, sharing God's gift of the 10 best ways to live. I take the pieces of a puzzle from a large red heart-shaped box. Love God, says one piece. Love people, says another piece. God loves you, says yet another. I take this heart-shaped puzzle and I place it in the sand, and then I begin to place 10 tablets in the sand for the children to see as they hear God's words. Don't serve other gods. Make no idols to worship. Be serious when you say my name. Keep the Sabbath holy. Honor your father and mother. Don't kill. Don't break your marriage. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't even want what others have. The children strike up a lively conversation. Sometimes I dream that God comes and kisses me goodnight. My daddy says God's name, and my mommy says it's a bad word. I love Sunday. We get to eat pancakes, and then the whole family comes to church together. This church helps God, like the way we make sandwiches for people who are hungry. A few children speak a different kind of truth. I told a lie at school this week. My parents are divorced. I don't know who my mother is. Somebody killed my brother. My sister is always taking my toys, and it makes me really angry. Energy fills the room, a community of God's children contemplating the 10 best ways to live, wondering together, whatever does it mean to love God, to love people, because God loves us. Two stories, two very different responses. It matters, my friends, where we begin. Today, as a church, we find ourselves almost halfway through our Lenten journey. It's a critical moment on our way to Easter. Fred Craddock, one of the great preachers of our time, has suggested that Lent carries a seductive danger. For the possibility exists that in our desert journeying of prayer and fasting and repentance, we may find ourselves mired in melancholy, feeling more failure than faithful. Like me and my Ten Commandments charm bracelet, working so very hard to be good girls and boys before God, we can find ourselves so focused on our personal sins and shortcomings and so determined to fix them for ourselves that our vision grows smaller. Trying and trying to redeem ourselves, we discover that we cannot. Our efforts to save ourselves by ourselves only exhaust us. My friends, we forget to remember. I am the Lord your God, who has brought you out of slavery into freedom. Consider, on the other hand, the godly play children, rooted in God and God's story, practiced in wonder and contemplation, engaged in a community of God's people. What opens is the possibilities of holy imagination and sacred play. And a loving response emerges. God's 10 best ways to live unfold in ways that are full of excitement and full of joy. It matters where we begin our Lenten practice. It helps if we begin with God and not ourselves, remembering God's life, God's love, God's people. The psalm we heard sung this morning serves as an antidote for our forgetfulness. It prods our memory. It too has three parts: God's creative handiwork in nature, God's liberating word in the law, God's redemptive and healing power. The psalm opens with the entire cosmos and comes to rest in our intimately personal hearts. It pulsates with the energy of nature and with motion. The heavens declare the glory of God. What is visible becomes vocal. Everything God has made witnesses to God in a chorus of praise, rising and soaring, rising and soaring, rising and soaring, until wordless rapture, speechless speech. They have no words, they have no language, and yet their sound has gone out, and their message has been heard. We pause. Worship and wonder, reverence and awe. Remember God's handiwork, God's creation. A Cherokee musician friend sought out a tribal elder. He wanted to know how to discover the sacred songs that he would play on the flute he had fashioned from river cane. "Go back to the river," the elder counseled. "Listen to the river and the rocks, the wind and the water, the tree, the cane, and the birds. They will sing God's music to you. Listen long enough, wait patiently enough, and nature will sing God's song for you." Sometimes we experience God most deeply when we part company with words. And yet, sometimes when we get caught up in the world's problems, we need more than to remember God's work in nature. And here the psalm turns. Surely a God who creates such a world can be trusted to help us learn how to live in it. "Treasure the law," says the psalm. And here the word law means Torah. The first five books of Scripture, the story, the history, the poetry, the song, the struggle of God's life with God's people. Torah, the joy-bringing, light-bestowing, liberating law of God. Torah, to be followed in our lives and desired in our hearts. It matters where we start. Remember, the psalm says, "I am the Lord your God. I have acted and intervened, healed and heard, saved and served, that you might be free, free to be my people. I have borne you up on the wings of eagles." Remember. The psalm makes a final turn. It turns towards redemption. For before the law is about us, before it is about God, God invites us to participate in the healing of the world. God's creative handiwork, God's liberating law, come to us in clarity, in flesh, and in power in Jesus. Stretching out his arms upon the wood of the cross, we see God's most profound work, God's most liberating word, God's deepest love. Remember, he tells us as he hangs there, love God, love people, for God loves us, and God redeems our lives. So, my friends, where should you and I start in these final weeks of Lent? Charm bracelet or 10 best ways to live? Let us pray that we will not forget to remember God's creative handiwork, God's liberating law, God's redeeming love. And now let us pray as the psalmist prayed. Let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable unto you. O God, you strengthen us and you redeem our lives. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Loving God, you lead your people to freedom from all that enslaves us. Give us the commandments to shape our love for you and for one another. In Jesus, we experience the depths of your mercy. Grant that the prayers we say aloud and those we pray in our secret hearts may be worthy of your unbounded love. Lord, in your mercy, increase your church's resolve to follow the way of the cross, seeking your truth in our time, purifying the emotions and imaginations of our common life, bearing the shape of your life in the world. Lord, in your mercy, inspire all peoples of the earth to prepare an inheritance of peace for future generations, banishing that which weakens your creation, the brokenness of war, the brutality of poverty, the pervasiveness of violence. Lord, in your mercy, instill in us the will for justice, the heart for freedom, and the prophetic vision that inspired those who marched and spilled their blood on the Edmund Pettus Bridge 50 years ago, adamant that this nation recognize the rights and integrity of every person you have made. Lord, in your mercy, call the leaders of the world to exercise power with humility and openness, to receive the wisdom necessary to shape our global community in the ways of justice. Lord, in your mercy, make our experience of Lenten wilderness one of testing and triumph. By your Spirit, lead those preparing for baptism and all the baptized to a deeper oneness with Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, grant to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, grace sufficient to each day. We pray for prisoners and captives, for the stranger and the homeless, for the despairing and the anxious. Lord, in your mercy, draw all those who are dying and all who have died into your tender and merciful embrace. In your great compassion, bring us all at the last to the joy of rebirth and resurrection. Lord, in your mercy.
Holy are you, O God, and holy is your name. Your love for us is from everlasting to everlasting. Bend our lives toward your love, incline our hearts to keep your commandments, for in faithful obedience we discover light for our eyes, joy for our hearts, and refreshment for our sin-sick souls. In the name of Jesus, your Son and our Savior, we pray.
Amen.
Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Sam.
Good morning. I'm Jan Cope, Vicar of the Cathedral, and on behalf of our Dean and the Bishop of Washington and the entire Cathedral community, it's my joy and privilege to welcome you to our service this morning, those of you who are in the nave as well as those of you who are worshiping with us online. I understand that we have two visiting groups with us, the W.J. White Band from Texas. Where are you? Right there. Great to have you with us. And the Point Loma Presbyterian Church from California, where are you? Back in the back, great. Wonderful to have you with us as well. When you came in this morning, you received a bulletin insert with announcements about things going on in our community, and I commend those things to you. There are just a few that I'd like to highlight for you this morning. One is, for those of you who are part of our regular worshiping community, I hope that you've been reading and reflecting upon our daily Lenten meditations that are on our website. We still need a few more of you to write meditations, and so if the Spirit is moving you to share part of your journey in this Lenten time, there's an opportunity for you to do so, and there's information in the leaflet about that. Immediately following this service, our seminarian, Elizabeth Hadaway, will be leading our 20s and 30s in a Bible study on the Gospel of Mark. There's no prerequisite for homework. You can just go to the library, so I commend that to you. And then finally, this Saturday, we have a special Lenten Day, quiet day, that's being led by Bishop Carolyn Tanner Irish. It will be a wonderful opportunity to come together and reflect at this midpoint in your Lenten journey, so I commend that to you. There's information on how you can sign up for that in your leaflet, but also some information at the table, coffee table, and congregation table in the back. After this service, we invite you to join us for coffee and refreshments. For those of you who are on the south side of the cathedral, you may have noticed we've got quite a bit of construction going on, and so we would ask you after the service, for your own safety, to please use the center aisle to go to the front of the church and the coffee area. It would be quite a little traffic jam given what's going on in that area. So please, for your safety and convenience, use the center aisle. What we move into at this part in the service is the table, the Lord's table. As such, all of you who are desirous of a deeper relationship with God are encouraged and most welcome to receive Holy Communion. At that time in the service, just follow the instructions of our ushers. If you would prefer a blessing instead, just cross your arms over your chest like this, and we'll know that's your intention and desire. During the time of communion, we have healing ministers who would be honored to pray with and for you. They will be in Memorial Chapel, which is behind this platform and to my left, to pray with you for healing and mind, body, spirit relationship, the needs of this world. And as we take a minute to reflect on the myriad ways in which God showers blessings on us day by day, out of thanksgiving and gratitude, we have an opportunity to give back, to help this cathedral in our ministry to a hurting city and nation and world. And so we invite you to give as you are able. And now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O gracious God, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say, each in our own language, the prayer of Jesus' heart. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts with grace and thanksgiving. Let us pray. Merciful Lord, grant your people grace to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh, and all evil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow you, the only God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross, and follow him. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.